So my name is Mary MacPherson. I'm a design lead at Lloyds Banking Group up in Edinburgh, though I've got teams in Leeds and down here in London as well. And I'm going to talk to you this evening about building creative confidence in agile environments. And working for Lloyds, I can tell you it is an agile environment, but we'll give it a go anyway. I'll start with a little bit about me. The top bit's the exciting, fun bit. The bottom bit is my education and work history. I work to live my life. So here I am at Lloyds, Tesco Bank prior to that, RBS prior to that. You could say a bit of a career banker with a stint at Lidl in between. I lasted 9 months there on that graduate programme. So yeah, that is me. Sport, beer, family, dog, Edinburgh. So here I am, and I just wanted to give you a little bit of an insight as to what we do at Lloyds Bank in terms of design. So we have got a design team of about 500 people based around the UK, and the thing that galvanises us is to design for prosperity. We have got about 30 million customers across our Lloyds, Bank of Scotland, Halifax and MBNA brands and Scottish Widows. Oh, I'm doing what Kim did. It's very sensitive, isn't it? and yes, so designing for prosperity is the thing that motivates us. And that culminates in helping our colleagues as well as our customers end each day a little better than it started. And so we are trying to be different from the other incumbent banks and try to adopt a more humble mindset and try to think about how we can be far more inclusive and serve those 30 million customers differently and better. So I'm here to talk about Agile. Similarly to Kim, I'm of the view that lots of different people have got a very different view as to what Agile is and could be. I guess what I've got here is my view on it. I've worked with Agile type teams now for 6 years, all in the incumbent organizations that I mentioned earlier. But for me, it's far more than that 11-step manifesto that was really put together for software engineering some 20 years ago now. But I think it's really about mindset, first and foremost. Secondly, in big organizations, it's really the modern day change methodology. So rather than waterfall and prints, it is a way in which we're trying to transition to make everyday changes, be that infrastructure or customer change. I also believe it's a showcase of humble servant teamship. So you will often hear servant leadership mentioned in the same sentence as Agile. I think for me, given Agile takes together multidisciplinary teams, it's about being servants to one another and being massively respectful. And I think when really great teams work together, that is one of the things that you would observe. And collaboration, and I think Kim mentioned that, collaboration is absolutely key in Agile. And it's coming together to solve problems and co-create these solutions. So for the next 25 minutes or so, I guess I've put a few things together for our joint consideration. So firstly, we're going to talk on what I think an agile designer is and actually the different facets of the role that you need to take on beyond your main craft or guild. Secondly, how you design for value within an agile environment and what are the partnerships and the things that you might want to adopt and leverage to really make an impact. And then finally, a bit of a view as to how you might assemble a creative team within an agile environment. I'm happy to take questions throughout, or if you want them at the end, that's totally fine too. So, are we mostly designers here in the room this evening? Mostly? Oh, hi. We are so much more than designers, I should say. Designers are really very unique. We've got a really different mindset from our business colleagues and our engineers. And so I believe we're so much more. And so one of the first things that I think we're really well placed to be is that of strategic partner. Quite often, as designers, creatives, and indeed in businesses, people are kind of pigeonholed as a designer into be someone who will work within a feature team and actually in the nooks and the crannies of detail. I think we have within us a huge opportunity to partner managing directors, product owners, and others to help create a vision of the future organization. And indeed, your creativity and ability to visualize things and think very differently can bring to life ideas and aspirations that your business colleagues would never ever aspire to. So I think one of the key things that designers can be within all organizations, be it a organization like Monzo or one like Lloyds Bank, is that you can become a strategic partner, whatever kind of designer you are. Secondly to that, we're all problem solvers. When you think about design, you tend to think about how am I going to improve something for the end user? And I've kind of put a few pictures on this slide. I did this morning. I was thinking about the people that I work with to try and create solutions and solve problems with. On the left-hand side are the actuaries, the accountants, the analysts that I work with very regularly in insurance and wealth at Lloyds Bank. So there's a couple of things that you see in these people. Their head is in the sand and they don't want change to happen. So they kind of suffer from that ostrich syndrome. The second thing is that the kind of work that they do, they can be quite often the drains in a room. So they can be the mood hoovers, the people that think change is impossible and not find it really difficult to be creative and think about a different opportunity and a different future. So I think as a design team, we have it upon us to radiate and generate new ideas. So we are the radiators within the room, creating that warmth and that belief that we can do something better and different. And with our skills and the tools that we use in user research, in UX service design, we can radiate new and different ideas that are creative and different from, again, what your colleagues might think about, whether that is in a lab environment, feature teams, or within a wider organization. Designers are also really important and key team players. I know myself, I'm an introvert, and my strong preference is to probably go away and work in a booth on my own when I really need to think about something. However, on a day-to-day basis, it's really important that we are in amongst the action, working with our product owners, engineering leads, business analysts, and other SMEs to help change their way of working, but also shape the thinking of the outcomes that we want to achieve as a team. And I think McKinsey Quarterly consultancy kind of noted in 2018, I think they did a global study of about 5,000 organizations, and they found that one of the differentiator things in organizations that experienced massive growth over the last 5 years is that of design. And it's a team sport. And it is one that means that not only are the designers the designers, but your front-end devs or your business analysts can also be designers. And so it's really, design thinking is a way in which we can differentiate and stand out from the crowd. The very unique thing about designers is that we think about humans, users, customers, colleagues in a far more dedicated and different way. And within the room, you can be the person that can be talking about customer and with knowledge and in depth that no one else can. And so particularly those of you who are researchers in the room and the guys like Kim helps at Monzo, you're so very key because you're championing what customers really want. And when you're championing what customers really want, you're actually advising as to how an organization is going to create revenue and going to become profitable. And so you can help increase the confidence of that take-to-market product that it's going to fly and it's going to give return to the organization. And obviously, there's a plethora of different ways in which you can gain that insight. But the human champion is really the really standout thing that you can do as a design member of a team. So with all of that in mind, if you're thinking strategically, if you're using creativity that isn't commonplace elsewhere in your organization, if you're able to talk with fact and data and insight from customers, you're in a prime position to influence. So I believe design is a really key influencer at a feature team level, at a department level, and indeed at an organizational level. And I think it's upon all of us to think of ourselves in this way, to elevate design community here in the UK and financial services and the other sectors that you maybe come from. So, second element of what I'm going to talk to you this evening is about building the creative confidence in the agile environments, like I said. So there's a few different facets to this, and I'll maybe touch upon some of the more specific things with regard to Agile. And some of you will be very well versed in this, so I apologise if it's duplication of things that you already know. So within Agile, you typically have a construct where you have designers, product owners, and engineers. And actually, that triad of capability brings together what I believe to be the best product construct that you can get in a team. So as designers, we are primarily here to help provide a product owner with the insight and to give a view of the desirability of a solution that we're either designing or it is in live, and we're able to give them feedback on that. And from a product perspective, so propositions are indeed product owner, depending on how your organization's structured, they need to think about the viability of it. Are we going to make money from this? And quite often there's a clash of civilizations there, because users might say they want something, the designer might fall in love with it, but actually it's not going to make us any money. So sometimes we need to think about how we balance what we believe to be desirable with what is indeed viable for the organization. And then also, typically within your feature teams, and this scales up as well, we work with engineers. Without the engineering community, it's very unlikely that any of our designs will ever go live. And so one of the key considerations, particularly in incumbent organizations, is the feasibility of your design. And again, it's great having lots of great designs, lots of good ideas, but if you're unable to execute and get that into life within a reasonable amount of time, it's probably not going to be feasible for the organization. So as a designer, I think it is incumbent upon us to think beyond just the human element, but also think a little bit more holistically and consider this as also viable and feasible for the organization. And we can partner the product owner in helping them come to the conclusion as to what the right thing to do is, because I suppose what you never want to happen is that it's going to make a company lots of money and it's really easy to get to market, but it's really grim for customers. And you'll see that in banking. That absolutely is still a mindset that we need to break down. So in terms of the agile kind of method and the way in which we deliver change, it's a real informant. And I think about some of the tools in your kit bag and some of the methods that you may use. And I think, again, this kind of gives a view as to why design is so incredibly important in agile delivery. So we are the people that bring together customers and colleagues to ideate and co-create. So before you even get into a development phase, we are helping organizations think differently about how we amass new and different ideas before you even go into an assessment of feasibility and viability. And the skills that you have are so very vital in that space. Very few colleagues are able to facilitate sessions. And if you were to ask, you know, a business analyst to go and do some customer research, they're unlikely to be able to do that with a lot of confidence. So again, to get a project started, our skills are really important. And we've also got methods and tools that unleash our own curiosity and also help others realize theirs. And if you work in a big organization, you'll work with lots of people who've never done design or thought about things in a different way before. And through ideation sessions, how might we, as well as doing lots of different types of research beyond that of customer, but thinking about quantitative, market, political, economic, social, and technology research, you can come together and create a very rich picture to help a product owner think about what it is they should create for their target product and their go-live proposition. I think the other thing that is really important within the Agile life cycle is that we do experimentation, we do MVPs, long before we get into live. And actually, we're very well placed to help the product owners and the analysts and the engineering leads think about what are the hypotheses that we want to test? What are the things we want to understand before we invest the money to do the build and put something into live? And through our testing with customers, be it digital or in labs, we're able to kill ideas. And it's one of the best things that you can help an organization with, which seems counterintuitive. But some of my greatest successes have been seeing great ideas that were going to make an organization lots of money, but didn't test well and not go into production. So I think as a mindset, it might feel a little bit negative, but again, we have the tools to help inform what the right thing to do is for the organization. And through the testing, we can inform iteration, and we can take things from low fidelity sketches to high fidelity prototypes. And actually, we need to be involved from the start to the finish of the process. And the process for me, and I don't really like the word process, but I guess the life cycle, is we start with concepts. We can grow these into prototypes. We can take them into experimentation, grow those into MVPs, and then once in live, and this is kind of like the question that the lady at the front asked him about, once you're in live, are you measuring it? And are we still iterating on it? And that is really, really important. Quite often incumbent organizations, we're very good at concepting and prototyping. Then we hand over to engineers for experiments and MVPs, and then we don't have a very good sustainable measurement capability. And I think that's something we probably need to get better at as a design community, to think about how we use data and work with data scientists to build measurement. Another one of our superpowers, not mine personally, but for those of you who are on a more creative scale than myself, is visualization. A really key thing in Agile is that you can walk into an environment and you can see the work in action and you can understand what a team is doing. So visualization is incredibly important. It's also really important because if you're working with lots of different disciplines and people with different backgrounds, one thing people can normally come together on is a picture. And designers have got an amazing capability of creating a visual that might take 1,000 words to describe, but you put it in front of a group of people, say a backlog refinement meeting, and they all get very clear as to what a user story as an example is actually saying. And so your ability to visualize concepts, to create sketches, prototypes on Envision and that kind of thing is such an important skill in that Agile process because it brings to life what that target is. Not only that, if you think about a service blueprint, and I'm sure some of you, if not all of you, are really familiar with that as a tool, you can start to string together what the level of effort is to make this journey a reality. And actually, that's really important in that Agile development journey because you start to understand the order of things, the priorities, and what it means right down here from a back-end engineering perspective, as well as the back office, as well as the customer journey. And again, you're the only people in your organization that are probably able to create something to give that 3D image of actually what a new proposition really means for an organization. There's Kanban, there's Scrum, there's various different ways to do Agile. I don't supposed to be an expert in any of these things. But I did give a little bit of thought as to how designers, we can use those ceremonies that you typically get in most types of Agile. So firstly, I think sprint planning is really important to attend. And I've seen scenarios when I've been a product owner when the design community didn't turn up. And we would estimate how long the work would take for my UX and UI designers in a sprint. It's really important that designers are involved in all the ceremonies because we're massively misunderstood. People think what you do is very easy and it's light touch and it'll be fast. So it's important to be involved to help create a view as to the level of effort it takes to actually do the creative on a front end build. Stand-ups, daily things, obviously you probably have them in your organisations. I think the key call out there is I quite often see people who are not engineers not really shouting out for help. And I think as a design team, we can do better to sort of stand up and say when we were blocked and don't kind of over-own things. A little bit like Kim was saying, don't take on that chimp of others. I think one of the most key and effective ceremonies in Agile for the design community is that of backlog and story refinement. So I think that's where you can get your visuals, put them in front of your development community, and actually help the product owner understand what should be the priority and actually think about what we need to do to get a user story into a place where it can be taken into production. And the final one, show and tells or end of sprint, showcases, they have different terminologies. I get quite upset when product owners represent my team's work. And I think as designers, we could and should be better at being the facilitators or people at these show and tells, showing the work that we've done to show the value that we've driven in the organization. I was just going to quickly, briefly touch upon user stories, which is getting into minor depths of Agile. But I think they're really important for us as a design community because they are the user stories, and that is kind of the thing that you're very interested in, I would imagine. And during sprint backlog refinement sessions, these are our opportunities to get user stories to a ready state. They can't go into sprint planning until they're ready state. And so it's here that you need to kind of be working with the product owners and the engineers to give a view as to what is good enough to build. And we should have a really strong voice in that. And I think that readiness criteria that you attach to user story can help with the quality of what it is that you deliver. And then equally the done piece. So pre-sprint, backlog refinement, helping understand what the ready criteria is for a user story to get into sprint planning. And then in the sprint, work with the QA engineers, as well as the product owners, to give a view as to what is acceptable. What is going to be an acceptable outcome for that user story that we would consider to be good enough to be done. So, covered off a little bit there about Agile and the more specifics. And I'm just going to close on how you might assemble a creative team. And I don't think there's any science. In the past few organizations I've worked in, we've done it in very different ways. And I don't think we've struck gold yet. Observations I do have from all the organizations that I've worked with design teams is quite often business or technology rules the day. And that's massively frustrating for us as a community. And that means our users, the people, our customers are not being listened to. And I quite often work with researchers and go to have conversations with product owners to help them try and articulate and listen what the customers really want and why it's important to use that. A second big thing, this might not be so much in Monzo, I hope it's not yet, because you haven't got the scale and you haven't got the archaic technology that I've had the joy of working with my entire life. But quite often, as designers, we generate the most awesome ideas that we see people like Monzo doing, and yet you can't get it into production. And that's a real challenge, to keep a creative team really motivated when they know that it's probably doable, but we just can't get to it because our infrastructure or tech's not there. Design crafts are misunderstood. We are so multifaceted, it's untrue, and we're quite often just labeled a design team. And I think that causes a lot of frustration when you bring together a creative team in an agile environment. I also often see, and I get frustrated myself, that designer kind of asked in to help do the coloring in at the end of the process. So once we're in production, it's okay, we'll do discover, we'll do incubation. When we're just going into production, we'll get a UX, UI guy, and they'll do some coloring in for us. It's frankly not good enough. And we need to continually, I guess, fight and be really strong that we should be there from day one of any product development piece in an agile sprint, or indeed the years of work that it may take. I guess we chop and change a lot in agile. I personally really like that and find that invigorating. A lot of designers put a lot of effort in. We put a lot of effort in, and we're very proud of the work that we showcase. When it doesn't get into production or changes are made that we don't agree with, that can be really challenging. And then finally, I guess with the research community, I see this a lot, is sometimes you need to be reflective and you need to take a couple of days out, maybe not even in the office, and synthesize those 1,000 customers that you've done some quant with. What does it all mean? What is the sense? And in Agile, quite often we just want to get into production and we don't give the necessary time for people to be reflective and make sense as to what feedback says. I'll just skip through that. This is just what we are at Lloyds. Rightly or wrongly, I think maybe wrongly, we've decided we're lots of different guilds. And so actually that's become very hard for engineering leads and product owners to understand. But then equally, they kind of need to understand that, because me as a single designer can't do everything. And through that agile process, we need different skills and different colleagues involved at different times. So I guess a couple of provocations just as I close off, just got a couple more minutes. So I work in Edinburgh. Scottish Widows is the brand that we primarily support. And we've got a financial planning and retirement lab, and we've got GIMP, which I'm part of. I know it's exciting stuff. But we've got two different models working in parallel. In the financial planning area, we've basically just set up design squads. So they go about in their little squads of all these different skills, and they work alongside a lab. They're not interdispersed with the feature teams. The guys who work with me are very much immersed within feature teams. Plus, I also have a design ahead team that are at a lab or a pan lab level rather than within feature teams. I don't necessarily think there's a right or a wrong. My observation of having a solo design team is that you unknowingly can fall into a waterfall trap, whereby the PO gives you a requirement, the design team goes away, they do something, you know, in a silo, then present it back, and then it's actually not what the PO wants. Equally, when they're immersed in the feature team, your skill set isn't so well understood, and actually that's where frustration can come for individuals, and they don't have creatives around them to bounce ideas. Quite a lot of my role is to do with resourcing of the fabulous talent that we have here at Lloyds. And one of the considerations we give is, should a designer stay with a feature team and subject area for a long time and become an SME? And when they do that, what you see, people become fantastically specialist and a really incredible, passionate advocate. I'm an advocate for protection insurance. I wouldn't have said that's what I was going to become 14 months ago. But then equally, now I've been working on the same subject area for 14 months, I'm starting to get so blind. My ability to think differently and create fresh ideas for my organization is starting to wane. So I think when we're creating creative teams in agile environments, we need to be mindful as to how long is too long in a single team and what is the right way to mix skill and experience. The final bit, when do you design? Because I've got a project running at the moment where the capability, the engineering technology capability is 12 months away from being born, but we've already designed the customer journey pretty much end to end. We've got screens, we know how the front end's going to look, but I've got no back end to plug into. A couple of my interaction designers are very angry about this because they've done all this great work, but it's not going to go into a customer's hand for a year. That's problematic. And equally, what we've designed now is probably going to be out of date and irrelevant in a year's time, and we're going to have to redo stuff. So I think we need to be mindful, and I think it will vary from organization to organization, but when is the right time to do design, and how much do you do at a high level, that strategic kind of North Star vision with a product owner, but when is it that you should be doing the more in-depth stuff with your feature team? And that's it. I hope that was in part insightful or got you thinking about Agile in a different or way that you're familiar with already. I'm not sure if we've got time for questions or not. Yeah.
Questions?
Okay. Hi there. I manage a small team of designers, and I couldn't. It really resonated with me when you mentioned how, you know, I've seen product managers totally kill lots of really good design work. I mean, any tricks into making sure that doesn't happen?
So I think it does happen all the time, unfortunately. Something that I've deployed over the last year that I probably haven't done a good enough job of doing in previous roles is use a mix of qualitative, quantitative, and other research in the mix. So quite often I would use focus groups, one-to-one interviews, and give a view as to what a handful of people thought. And that, in the financial world that I work in, is never enough because they're like, how would we ever make a decision based upon what 20 people think? They just don't trust the process. They don't understand it, and that's okay. So what we've started to do more and more within my team is large-scale quantitative research in tandem, as well as taking a bigger view of what is going on from a political, economic, and social and technology perspective. And actually what I've found when you take all those different facets together and have a conversation, say, with an executive or a product owner, it's far more fact-based and it's very holistic. And therefore, it's really the data and the output and the outcomes talking to them rather than me or my researcher. So I think there's something about using a variety of techniques and presenting it as one. I think I've seen that being quite successful. Equally, I have got one stakeholder I work with, and he's worked in insurance for the last 25 years and knows exactly what customers want. And the researchers will do their very best, and I will do my very best, but I'm unlikely to ever change his mind. So I think there are some stakeholders that will always be a challenge, but where I've had traction in the last year, it's been when I've combined different methods.
So it's a multifaceted attack.
Absolutely, and also get them involved. So we're really fortunate that we've got labs, you may do too, in our offices. So we just get the execs down kind of listening and seeing customers. I use videos quite a lot. So rather than me and my team say anything, we just play the videos of customers. It smacks them in the face pretty hard. It's really, really effective.
That's great, thank you.
Okay.
Hi, Mary. How do you work out when the architect say, it's lovely, amazing idea, but it's technically not possible with our infrastructure?
Initially get a sad face. But no, in seriousness, I've been fortunate that I've been a product owner and I got to work with engineers for about 3 years of my career. And that knowledge has stood me in really good stead because I can smell bullshit to a greater extent than I could previously. What I tend to do, so I think there will be infrastructure architects and engineers who, while they work really in a change function, they don't want to change or deviate from their idea. They do want to change, but they don't want to deviate from their plan. I think that's when you call upon enterprise architects and think about other people around the organization that can go and assess it for you. I think anything is possible, really, in the domain that I work in. So when someone says we can't do it or it is impossible, I kind of turn the question to go, well, why is that factually the case? And I start a conversation on how might we do it. So it might be really difficult. And something I found a lot in Lloyds is when people tel me I can't do it and you kind of peel the onion, it's just really, really difficult. That's not a reason not to do it because the customer ultimately will be the person that has to compensate for that. And so I think it's using specialists around you, but also taking a tack of, well, how might we do it? Because no is never really the right answer. And that's why we're all employed. If, you know, it's to make stuff happen. And so we need to kind of work with engineers to help them think creatively. And some of them are incredibly creative and are really up for it. And I suppose it's about finding those allies in the organization and kind of working with them quite closely.
Any more questions? Going once, going twice, okay. A big round of applause for Mary.